Well, I don't want to be a pessimist, and I don't think I am. But during these recent years, I was dragged more and more into this belief that it doesn't matter who we are or where we are, we all have this sick side inside us, which tends to experience, feel, and see the nasty moments filled with violence. And the more we let it free, the more it will progress. If you just give me a little bit of time, I will explain my review through my today's movie analysis. Today, I'm gonna give analysis on two movies created by the same director, with the same theme, and with the same story. And you are not only going to get a good analysis about them, but you are going to hear some interesting criminology facts I found about them.
Okay, let's play another game. It's a guessing game.
Warmer. Cold. Really warm.
So the movie is Funny Games, and there are two versions of it. One of them is in English, created in 2007, and another one is in 1997 in German language. So they both have been directed by a director whose name is Michael Haneke. I guess it is the right pronunciation. They both have the same plot, and they are shot by shot the same. So if I want to tell you about the plot, it starts with a family, which includes a mother, Anna, and a father, George, and a son whose name is Georgie. They arrive at their holiday home, and in the first moments of the movie, they spot two young men, whose names are Paul and Peter. These two young men are not from that neighborhood, and there are some excuses why they are walking in there. Shortly after, the family find their behavior disturbing.
Can help us figure out this misunderstanding.
George, please!
Dad, I can't.
Hey.
Peter and Paul are trying to communicate with this family, but they are just making a mess. They break the eggs and they break the phone deliberately, but they pretend they are just being clumsy. So the atmosphere and the situation gets more and more toxic, and the family gets real tension. After a while, they find the two young men villains who want to hurt them in some way. The whole movie reminds you of those nightmares in which you feel your feet numb. Your actions are only a waste of time, which are only driving you to the disastrous moment. There is literally no way for you to tear up this dream, because you are not meant to survive. You're just a doll, just an object, just like this table or a spoon, which has no ability to choose the fate. So also about this movie, it doesn't matter how hard the victims are trying, how far Georgie is running, and how carefully their mother is trying to reach to somewhere. So they are not going to get any good results only because the director doesn't want to. Maybe you will come up with this question, that's why. Is the director trying to be different than others? Or is he just messing with our minds? The answer is yes. He is trying to be different, and he successfully could be. And yes, he's messing with our minds. Remember the name of the movie, Funny Games? So it's all just a game in which the director is manipulating everything necessarily in the way that he wants to, and he doesn't care what you want to see. And this whole idea of the movie gets bolder when Anna asks one of the villains, that's why don't you just kill us? And they respond, don't forget the importance of entertainment. We can see the perfect power on the victims when Paul and Peter just leave the scene with no fear of being traced by the police. And after an hour, they just get back to the scene again. They just leave freely and get back again. They murder the neighbors one after each other. And these whole people, like 10 people, they can do nothing. They cannot even make a simple call to police. So this movie is the world which only and only belongs to Peter and Paul. And in this world, reality doesn't matter. They are the ones who run the rules. Almost in all scenes of the movie, I can feel that the director is giving us a smirk, like he's mocking us. Especially the ending, when Anna reaches the shotgun and she shot Peter. But suddenly Paul says no, no, and he grabs the remote control and changes the channel. He goes back in time, and instead of losing, he wins the game. In this world made by Peter and Paul, there is no action against them. So he changes the channel, and we, instead of watching an ordinary popcorn horror movie with the same old story and the characters who always get to destroy the villains, we get the chance to watch something different. I could even feel it that the director is laughing at our little hopes. When Peter and Paul kept Anna alive, so we were imagining that something is going to change. Maybe she is alive for a reason, but they just very easily and pointlessly killed her. Just like throwing your waste into the trash bin. The moment that Paul turns back to camera and he winks at us, I felt like we are being dragged to the TV through the screen. Like he knows us and we know these villains. And there is a friendship and a connection between us. Exactly like we are having a role in this horrible game. Watching enthusiastically this poor lady who is unknowingly going toward the corpse. I believe that Paul and Peter can be supposed as the media. The media which is always preparing for us all those terrifying scenes of some horror movies or video clips or so many others, just so we can have some moments of pleasure. We are truly thirsty for entertainment. Aren't we? Yes, we are. Just like Peter and Paul. We are not murdering anybody and achieving pleasure out of it. I know, this sick side of us every time enjoys the horrible scenes of the horror movies. Otherwise, what is the reason of gathering with our friends, holding our popcorn and soda, and watching the misery of others through something called movie? If you disagree or agree with my opinion, then I would like to hear yours, so you can comment your opinion here under my video. I'm gonna flashback again to that scene that Anna says, "Why don't you just kill us?" And they respond, "Don't forget the importance of entertainment." Do you see our similarity with Paul and Peter? How could be a horror movie fun when all the characters die in the first 5 minutes of the movie? It's supposed to be a game, it must be fun, so it must take longer. So we can say Peter and Paul are a symbol of us and a symbol of media at the same time. I mean, this is my view. The notable point is that the violence in Hanek's movies remain off screen. And Hanek, in one of his interviews, said that I don't really want to be a part of this violence pornography of the mass media. So if my theory be right, he didn't want to show the violence, but he wanted to show how we and the media is thirsty for violence. Now let's go to the criminology part and some analysis on Peter and Paul character. Based on what the director has said, Peter and Paul are calling each other by different names, like Tom and Jerry or something else. And this shows they don't have a true identity. And also based on some studies I just had, we can maybe categorize them into one or two different types of the criminals. So if I want to tell you about a little bit of the categories in criminology field related to murderers and villains, then I have to say there are some different groups. We have the mission-oriented criminals, the visionary criminals, power control ones, and the last one is hedonist. So who are the mission-oriented criminals? They are the ones who kill a specific group of people. For example, Hitler was a mission-oriented criminal because he believed that the Jews need to be destroyed because of some special reasons. The missionary ones are kind of delusional. They think that someone like God or an angel is asking them to kill a group of people. So I think that Peter and Paul, they cannot belong to these two categories. But the other two ones, maybe. The power control ones want to have a perfect control over their victims, and it includes how and when they must die. Although they may commit a sexual assault, but they don't get any pleasure out of it. They just use it as a tool to have power over the victim. So in that scene that they want Anna to get naked, it makes me think that maybe they belong to this category of power control. Also, they may leave their victims, but they will return to them to show their power in another way. So you can totally match that scene in which Peter and Paul just left the house and they got back again. On the other hand, the hedonist ones, they kill for pleasure. It can be a sexual pleasure, or it can be just because it is thrilling for them, or they may kill for money. So the first group is for lust, the second one is for thrill, and the third one is for financial comfort. In all these three categories, mentally and physically torturing the victims makes them excited. So Peter and Paul can be included in the category of power control or the hedonist, or maybe both of them because they can overlap. Also, I need to say that I'm not an expert or a criminologist, and this movie is surely not based on the criminology data. So it's only just what I'm saying. Okay, oh my god, I'm talking like it's so fun to talk about people getting murdered. So this was my analysis, and I hope you liked it. If you liked it, comment your opinion, and also don't forget to like my video. If you disagree or agree with my opinion, then I would like to hear yours, so you can comment your opinion here under my video. Remember to subscribe my channel so you can have the next following videos and top movie lists. And as always, I have this Telegram channel in which I put all the perfect soundtracks of the movies. So if you'd like to have those, don't forget to join my Telegram channel by the link that I put in the description. Until the next video, good afternoon, good evening, and good night.